Welcome to our New Life Aurora online campus. We're so thankful that you're taking the time to join us today. Please go to auroranewlife.com/connect so that we can connect with you. Let us know about any prayer needs that you have so that we can pray for them throughout the week. You can also go to auroranewlife.com/give to submit your tithes and offerings. Because of your faithfulness and giving, we're able to continue the ministries at New Life and support our missionaries all over the world. We pray that your faith is encouraged by the message that you hear.
Everybody's like, Dan, what are you doing?
Awesome.
It's good to see everybody this morning. One of the most amazing scripture verses. It's almost poetic in the way it says it. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. It's a wonderful sense of promise. It's a declaration as well of what he has done. And I think it's a reminder of the love that he has continuing for us through all things. Amen. So stand with me this morning. Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water, come and thirst no more.
Oh,
cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world. Your love is like radiant diamonds bursting inside us that we cannot contain. Your love will surely come find us like blazing wildfires singing. Church, it's amazing to recognize how God's love completely changes us from the inside out. Amen.
Amen.
Come on. Your love is, yeah, like radiant diamond bursting inside us that we cannot contain. Your love will surely come find us like blazing wildfires singing your name.
Yeah.
Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world. And I searched the world, it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. You came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you, nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. Thank you, Lord. Not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you see them all, and you still call me your friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and then your mercy and grace won't find me again and again and again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing, nothing is better than you. You are everything. Sometimes we need to be reminded of what he does. And we say these words. You turn mourning to dancing.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens.
Amen.
You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves. You're the only one who can change everything that's overwhelming. Your power and your mind, your justice and your strength will continue to work in our lives.
Thank you, God.
Even when things seem so confusing,
yes, God.
I know you are the one that I can trust through this night. And when people just talk too much and say things, there's just one that I can trust. It's my Savior. Came to die for me and give me freedom, give me joy,
praise you, God.
Give me everlasting hope.
Thank you, God. Praise
you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you.
There's nothing.
Nothing is better than you.
Why is there nothing better than the Lord? Has he done anything for you? Has he ever shown you that he knows you, that he cares about you? Has he ever provided for you? Has he ever done anything for you? If he has, can we just take a moment? Can we tell him? Let's remind ourselves. He knows. Can we remind ourselves why there's nothing in this universe better than our Lord? Father, we thank you. We praise you this morning. It's easy. It's easy, Lord, when I think about who you are and yet how much you care for us. For you so loved each one of us. You so loved the world. You loved me that you sent your Son. And because we believed, Lord, we have everlasting life with you forever. And Lord, because we know you, because you know us, you've been there for us. The times we called out to you, there were times where you were the only answer. You were the only solution. And we need you to make a way where there was no way. There are times, Lord, we've been going about our lives, but as we look back now and see, we can see the fingerprints, your fingerprints, that you were at work and you were moving and you were doing something. Sometimes we couldn't even see it. But now we look and we can see. As we look back and see your faithfulness and we see your goodness, we see your love and your care for us. The psalmist in Psalm 100, verse 5 says this, "For the Lord is good." Why is he good? His unfailing love continues forever. This morning, God's love for you continues. It does not fail. It does not stop. And maybe there's a situation in your life, in a relationship, or in your finances, or in your health, or something else that you need the Lord to show up. You need him to show himself. For the Lord is good, his unfailing love continues forever, and his faithfulness continues to every generation. His faithfulness is there for you today. Lord, we invite you into our lives and our situations. you're the one who make gardens in places where there once was dryness and death. You're the one who can bring fruitfulness to lives that were messed up or self-focused or had no purpose. You're the one who answers every question, for you the answer. And your amazing love never stops. And we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Any good? Amen. So glad you're here this morning. Why don't you turn and wave at somebody as you have a seat? So glad you're here today, part of our family service. Well, my name is Pastor Stuart Ross, and I have the privilege of serving as the lead pastor here at New Life. And if this is your first time or first time in a long time, I want to welcome you as well. So glad that you're here for all of us. And the seat back in front of you is the Connect card. And so if you can fill that out, let us know your information so we can let you know what's going on and connect with you. If you have needs or if you need a, have a prayer request, you can put that on here as well. And put these cards in the white box on the table in the lobby, and we'd be glad to connect with you. And we'd love to know how we could serve you better. Well, I want to share a couple announcements with you. Before I do that, I just wanted to remember last Sunday. Many of you were here last Sunday. We're not here, but with us as we celebrated joint service together at Hudson Springs Park in a beautiful setting, both campuses, Stowe and Aurora, together. That was a great time. If you weren't there, we missed you. But we had a great time together in that setting. I was thinking this week when it got a little cooler, I was thinking, boy, I wish it had been a little cooler last Sunday, though. How many of you were there? It was a little warm, right? And a little hot. I really felt bad for our worship team, because where we put them, they were like in the sun the entire time, and they were up there a long time. So kudos to everybody who served. Thank you guys so much. But then I woke up this morning, and I walked outside, and I saw the rain, and then all of a sudden, I wasn't thinking about cool weather. I was thinking, oh, I'm so glad it didn't rain last Sunday. That would have been bad. So praise God for that. So sometimes you got to kind of remind yourself why you're thankful, right? So I was thankful for that. So really appreciated that time together. I want to let you know what's going on. Coming up soon, actually starting next Sunday, is going to be a time of prayer and fasting for our church. How many of you would recognize and say with me that it's just astounding and sometimes heartbreaking to read all the things that are going on in this world? I mean, think about what's going on in the Middle East and in places all around the world. Every country around the world is still dealing with coronavirus. I mean, when that first hit, we all thought it hoped to be over after a few months. Here we are still dealing with that. Just this past week, I learned of three people that I know, fellow pastors and students in the program that I'm in, who passed away because of COVID this week. And it's terrible, all the things that are going on. And I don't know about you, but I think we need to pray. And we need to pray for our community. There's a lot going on in our community here in the Cleveland and Akron areas. We need to pray for our community. But we also want to pray for our church. In the fall, in October, November, we're going to be doing an all-church series called Why Church? And be looking through the reasons. Why do we do church? What is church all about? What's it supposed to be? And so we're going to be having a preaching series through that. But then we'll have a small group study. So everyone is not already in a small group. We're going to have several small groups that will be ready for you and you can be part of during that time. We'll meet four times during those 8 weeks of October and November and study through the messages as well. So you'll be hearing more about that in the next couple of weeks. But we want to be praying in advance of that. So next Sunday night is our monthly encounter service. It's going to be here at Aurora at 6 p.m. So I ask you to kind of note that on your calendar. We'd love to have you here. Please join us in prayers. We pray for our country. We pray for the world. We pray for our community. And we pray for our church. And because of Encounter being next week, there won't be a youth group tonight here, but the youth will join us next Sunday as part of Encounter. What we'll be doing for that week, so it's a time of prayer and fasting. It starts at Encounter service next Sunday night. But then for Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, we're going to be at times of prayer and fasting through there. So the church will be open every night at 7 p.m. on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. You come and join us for an hour. People will be praying individually. Then we'll join together at the end for a time of prayer for those issues and be praying for our church. Because we know God wants to meet people. God wants to show his power. He wants to show his love to people. And so we want to pray that God's going to help us as New Life to be prepared to invite, to reach out, to love others, and to connect with them and disciple them. So encourage you to be part of that. As far as the fasting side of that goes, we'll have a handout for you next week. It talks a little bit about more about prayer and fasting. But for fasting, for some it may be fasting a meal. Some may be able, each day. Some may be able to fast during the entire time period from Sunday night to Wednesday night. But we're just asking you to just prayerfully consider marking in some way, God, I'm devoting a piece of time every day to be praying for our country and be praying for our community and for our church. Does that sound good? Amen. It's very important. We want to do that. Well, part of our worship each week is we recognize that our giving is part of that. And so the Apostle Paul talks about this a little bit in a way in Colossians chapter 3. He says in verse 23, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you're serving. And you know, a Labor Day weekend is the kind of the one time a year we kind of, the whole point of having a Labor Day holiday, right? Why is there a Labor Day holiday, right? The point is that we take a time and we think and consider work. We consider what we do. And so whether we come from different walks of life and different work we may have, for some of us, our work may be more in the past. For some of us, we are right in the middle of our work life right now. And we may work different places, may work in manufacturing or healthcare or service industry or for the government and different agencies, whatever, in different ways we work. But wherever we work, we're not working for that organization. We're working for the Lord. What we do represents Him. And in fact, it's part of our worship because we recognize, we're thankful. We say to the Lord, thank you for the ability to work. Whatever it is we do, we thank the Lord we have the ability to do that. And so we give out of what we earn. Part of it's to take care of ourselves and our families. Part of it is to take care of others. But really what we're doing, that part of the worship is so that people can hear the good news. And so I want to thank you because your faithfulness in giving, as you're faithful, that makes a difference in people's lives in the ministry of the church. So thank you so much. Well, today we're concluding our series we've been doing in 1 and 2 Thessalonians. So if you grab your sermon notes that were in the bulletin, all right, I got a couple fill-in-the-blanks there for you. And so our series has been called It's Going to Be All Right. And so today we're looking at the final chapter of 2 Thessalonians and chapter 3. And so throughout these two letters, as we've been looking through them, we've learned to see how Paul's talking to the believers. He's talking about how they are walking in God's love, how they're walking in God's ways and being showing what it looks like to live a holy life in a very pagan place. But also, Paul talked a lot about the hope we have for the future, right? And all the things that are going on, and we think about all the things that are going on today, and we can get discouraged as we look at those things sometimes. But Paul says for us and for these believers back then, he says, no, we know how this ends. And Paul shared with us, listen, we're living in a time in between. Jesus came and died on the cross 2,000 years ago, and that made it possible for you and I to have a relationship with God. And that also means that God is with us every second of every day. But we still live in this world. And there's many things that go on, and bad things do happen to good people. And so what's going on? When we look at that, wait a second, we're living between the first coming and Christ's second coming. He's been talking a lot about that. We looked at that back in chapter 2 a couple weeks ago. But at that second coming, one day, people who say, well, I don't know if Christianity is real, I don't know if God's real, they'll know on that day. And so that gives us hope because we know God is at work. Sometimes we can't see it. Sometimes we can. But God is at work, but one day all will know, all will see. So we have that hope that brings us through tough times. So Paul's been talking about that here in chapter 3 as we look at it. In the situation we live in today, where there's evil still in the world, yet Paul told us in chapter 2, evil is also restrained by the presence of believers. The Holy Spirit operating through you and I is a restraint in a way on evil influences. But one day that's going to be removed. But we're living in this time in between. What is our responsibility for today? So I titled this message, Working While We Wait. Okay? So if you're here today or if you're watching this online, I got to give you just a little clue here. You might have heard me say this before. But whenever the preacher can get all the words to be from the same letter, working while we wait, that's how you know it's a good message. just want to let you know there. It's important. Okay, so this is a good message. Well, it's from God's word, so how can you go wrong, right? So Paul in this chapter is going to give us, he's going to address three questions, all right? Those are going to be our fill in the blanks. And the first one is, well, what is our work? So the word work is our fill in the blank. What's our work? What's our goal? What's our purpose? So read with me as we read verses 1 through 5. Paul says, as for other matters, so he's changing to go kind of the last thing he's going to talk about here. As for other matters, brothers and sisters, pray for us that the message of the Lord may be spread rapidly and be honored, just as it was with you. And pray that we may be delivered from wicked and evil people, for not everyone has faith. But the Lord is faithful, and he will strengthen you and protect you from the evil one. We have confidence in the Lord that you're doing and will continue to do the things we command. May the Lord direct your hearts into God's love and Christ's perseverance. Let's pray. Lord, we just ask in this moment that you would help us to understand what you're saying through your word. Because what you're saying here, Lord, can make all the difference into how we live each day. I pray you help us to understand on this Labor Day weekend, understand what our work is all about and why we do what we do. We pray this in Jesus' name. And together we say, amen. Amen. All right, so here at the end of the letter, Paul's gone through a number of important things, but there's one more thing he needs to talk about. But before he gets there, he first asks for prayer. Now, how many of you know it's not weak to ask for prayer? Right? Sometimes you ask people, how are you doing? Doing fine, right? Oh, everything's going well, right? But if you dig a little deeper, you find out there's actually things going on in that person's life you're talking to, and they might end up going, okay, well, yeah, if you could pray for that, that'd be great, right? Well, why didn't you start off with that, right? Because we don't want to appear to be needy, and I understand that. But really, Paul asked for prayer. Paul doesn't want to end his letter without saying, no, listen, before we get to the last thing, first, I need you to pray. Okay? And what does he ask for prayer for? He says, pray for him, pray for his mission team. He's got Silas and Timothy with him. Pray for us that the message of the Lord may spread rapidly and be honored. So there's two things we need to pray about here, two things we need to do, our work's going to do for us here. The first, as we wait, our work's going to accomplish some specific things. And the first is to pray. You and I need to pray. That's one of the reasons why we're gathered together for times of prayer next week. We pray on a regular basis, I hope, right? Each one of us. We pray at church. But we need to have a special time where we focus in and we say, Lord, I want my life to be such, I'm going to be aligned with you. Lord, these are the things that need to happen. We need to see these things happen. Will you work and will you move? And so then we're going to be ready to hear what the Lord's saying. And we're going to be able to see what the Lord's doing because we've been thinking about it and praying about it and asking him for it. So we need to pray. What's the first thing we need to pray for? That the message of the Lord will spread. What does Paul say here? He says, really, literally, he says, he prays that the message may run and be glorified. So imagine the message, the gospel, the good news of Jesus, right? And it's running, you know? Sometimes you're like, well, I don't know if what's going on in the world. It seems like the world's getting worse and there are more people like, well, they've lost their faith or they don't have faith in the first place. You know, what's going on with the gospel? Paul says, no. The gospel came to you and made a difference in your life. It transformed you, right? Let's pray that that same gospel will run and spread rapidly everywhere. That's a good prayer, isn't it? Right? That it would run on further. His second prayer request is a little different, though. He asks that he and those who are serving with him would be delivered and rescued from their enemies. Now, he says two things about their enemies. We want the message to be spread, but let's recognize there's opposition. Right? There's people who are wicked, and wicked means someone who's actually capable of harming someone else and not caring or actually wanting to harm someone else. And he also says they're evil. Not only are they thoroughly corrupted in themselves, but they're willing and want to corrupt other people. And you and I have run into people like this, right? You ever run into someone who didn't care about anybody else or actually was willing to do harmful things to other people? You ever met someone like that? Have you ever met anybody? Okay, right? If you've been breathing, you've met somebody like this, right? The thought that immediately came to my mind was, have you ever been driving down the road, right, or driving down the highway, and you're kind of obeying the speed limit? You know, within reasonable distance of it. Right? And all of a sudden, someone comes flying up on the right or the left of you on the highway and passes you, and you know they're going, like, way over the speed limit. And then they're weaving in and among cars. You ever see someone do that, right? Doesn't that make you mad? Because they're acting in a dangerous way. It's not just about them. They're gonna get hurt. They can hurt somebody else. They're driving this several thousand pound vehicle and they can hurt somebody, right? So does that ever make you mad when you see something like that happen on? Well, Paul's saying there's people out there who are willing to do evil. They don't care about anybody else, or actually, they're willing to do whatever it takes. They're going to do things that harm other people. And Paul says there's people out there like that. But there's going to be opposition. But Paul says, wait a second, though. Whose message is this anyways? Now, somebody might come to you one time and say something like this. Well, okay, you're one of those Christians. Well, how come, I mean, what makes you think that, like, what you believe is more right than what anyone else believes? I mean, how do you know that what you're saying is correct? Everyone's got different things and different things. What gives you the right to say that you can say what you believe? Now, I know no one's ever put it that way to you before, but I've had similar things happen to me. This I've talked to people. I might have mentioned this before, but sometimes when you ever sit on, if you ever been on an airplane and you sit next to somebody, sometimes they'll say, "Oh, so you know, who are you? Where are you from?" And you might get down to, "What do you do for a living?" Which I always hate when they ask that, because I have to say, "I'm a pastor." And they're like, oh, that's neat. Anyways, you know, whatever. Like, I want to talk to you, right? I'm going to be sitting next 2 hours sitting there next to a pastor, right? But I've had people say to me, well, what makes you think you have the right to, like, tell people they should believe what you believe? All right? Here's an answer to that. I'm not saying that. This isn't my message. This is God's message. I mean, God so loved the world that he has sent his son to make it possible for you and I to have a relationship with him, and so that message could be spread. I'm just doing God's work. I'm just trying to represent God well. This isn't my opinion. This is his. Now, if you want to argue with God and with Jesus Christ, that's a different issue, but you're not arguing with me. We need to take ourselves out of the equation here on that, right? Does that help? Okay. Paul says there's people that are out there. People might be against you. But verse 3, but the Lord is faithful. He will strengthen you and protect you from the evil one. Paul's saying, God's going to guard you from any assaults that may come against you. You and I don't have to be worried. We have to be full of fear. The Lord is faithful. He will strengthen us. Paul says in Philippians 1:6, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Until the day Jesus returns, God is at work in you, and he's not going to forget about you. He's like, okay, I've been working on you yesterday, and I'm working on you today, but tomorrow, oh, yeah, I forgot all about you. He's not going to forget about you, right? He is with you all the time, and is always thoughtful towards you. So that's part of what we're doing. Our message, our work, is to spread this message about Jesus Christ. But our work also is not just what we say, or not even just what we pray, is to show what it means to have new life in Christ. So verse 4, 5, and 5, Paul says, we have confidence in the Lord that you're doing and will continue to do the things we command. Well, what has Paul commanded them? He's talking to them about living a holy life, living in a very pagan, evil culture, right? He's saying, listen, this is how you follow the Lord. This is how you love others, right? He says in verse 5, may the Lord direct your hearts into God's love and Christ's perseverance. He's saying, may the Lord make straight. The word direct means may the Lord make straight your heart. The Lord wants to remove any obstacle that's in the way in your heart from understanding what God has for you. In my experience, for many believers, there's obstacles in the way. Like we sang, God loves me and there's nothing better than the Lord. But sometimes there's things in my heart. Maybe it's a hurt from the past. Maybe it's a situation today that's not resolved. Maybe it's a fear for the future. But there's often in believers, there's things in our hearts that are keeping us from totally experiencing what God has for us. I don't know about you, but when we sang that song about God's love, and he'll make a way, and he'll turn seas into highways, and he'll take graves and make them into gardens, did that feel good? Right? But you know what? For some of us, it was good, but we didn't get all of it. The Lord has more out there for you to experience. When the Lord says he loves you, that's even better than anyone in your family ever saying they love you. Because his love is complete. It's not dependent on your behavior. It's not dependent on how wonderful you are, how good looking, or how much hair you have. Right? Paul says, may the Lord direct your heart, remove all obstacles, so that you are completely into God's love. You know, people in this world will spend a lot of money and a lot of energy trying to find security so they feel secure. Some people try to find security in their jobs or in things or in other people, right? But you know what the best security there is to truly get all that it means, all that God has for you in his love. And the second part of that, may the Lord direct your hearts into the perseverance of Christ. What did Jesus have to go through for you and I to know God? At the end of the service, we're going to celebrate communion. We're going to celebrate and remember what Christ did on the cross for us. And we can think about the cross. We can think about the physical punishment that Christ went through and the pain that he went through on the cross physically. But the greatest thing that happened on the cross was that for the first time in the history of the universe, God the Son was separated from God the Father. Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why did he do that? But Jesus knew. I mean, the whole point in the Garden of Gethsemane, he didn't want to go through. He said, Lord, I don't want to do this. But then he said, okay, Lord, if that's your will, I'll do it. Jesus had to show the most amazing perseverance to know. He knew what he was going to go through, and yet he went through it. And for you and I, God may be asking us or bringing us through a very tough time right now. But Paul says, I pray that you have the perseverance of Jesus Christ. And you go through it, because on the other side of that is something that's going to be so amazing, more than you can ask or think. Okay, so that's the first thing. What's our work? With the love of God in our heart and the strength of Christ in our life, we can face anything, right? The second thing that Paul talks about here is what's the problem? There's a problem with our work. So now these verses, there's a lot to it. I'm going to read verses 6 to 15. But you got to stick with it because there's a lot going on here. We're going to make sure we get this clear here. What's the problem going on in the church? In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Paul says, we command you, brothers and sisters, to keep away from every believer who's idle and disruptive and does not live according to the teaching you received from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to follow our example. We were not idle when we were with you, nor did we eat anyone's food without paying for it. On the contrary, we worked night and day, laboring and toiling, so that we would not be a burden to any of you. We did this not because we don't have the right to such help, but in order to offer ourselves as a model for you to imitate. For even when we were with you, we gave you this rule. The one who is unwilling to work shall not eat. And we hear that some among you are idle and disruptive. They're not busy. They're busybodies. Such people we command and urge in the Lord Jesus Christ to settle down and earn the food they eat. As for you, brothers and sisters, never tire of doing what is good. Okay, now, there's a lot going on there, right? And the thing about whenever we read one of the letters of Paul or of Peter or John is that they're writing to a specific group of people who lived a long time ago in a different place, right? So our job is to look at what he's saying to them back then and say, how does that apply to today? So there is a good application here for us, and it relates to our work, but really it's a larger issue than just our work, although that's a big part of it. Paul says there's some believers there in the church, and the translation we use said the word idle, but actually a better translation of that is people who are unruly or disruptive, okay? So the problem isn't just that they're not willing to work, although that is a problem. We'll talk about that in a minute. It's not just that they're sitting there going, oh, well, yeah, we're just going to wait till Jesus returns, and we're not going to do a thing, lift a finger to then. That's not what's going on. What's going on is they're actually busy, but they're busy bodies. They're getting into other people's stuff. They're disrupting other people in the church. They're not being idle. They're being idle about not working, but they're actually very busy, but doing things that aren't productive. And so basically Paul's saying, listen, it's not enough just to be a neutral and not be bothering anybody else. God's calling you and I to be a positive in the church, but we know we're doing wrong if we're a negative in the church, right? Okay, so there's some reasons here. Paul's saying about them, I mean, they just don't realize that working is part of their witness and their worship to the Lord. Exodus 20 says, 6 days you shall labor and do your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord. And so our work can be a blessing. And there's three reasons here why we work. The first is, you see here in our notes, is to take care of ourselves. Now, lots of people will look at work as kind of a curse. You know, they're, oh, I got to go to work, right? But what's the alternative? Now, let's be clear before we go any further. We're not talking in this passage about people who are not able to work or not able to work in a way that earns enough for them to take care of themselves. I'm not talking about that at all, okay? I don't think the scripture is. He's talking about willingness, not about the amount of effort. We're also not talking about people who, maybe through no fault of them, find themselves in a situation where what they need to pay or what they need to do to live is beyond their ability. And so the church, we have a, for example, we have a benevolence fund that our leadership administers for people who find themselves in those kinds of situations. And I'm thankful that we live in a country where there are programs that can help people who are hungry and who are hurting. Can we agree on that? That's not a bad thing. But the problem here is there are people in the church who were asking other people in the church to take care of them because they weren't willing to take care of themselves. Again, they were doing these other things that were negative to the church as well. But the thing is, you got to take care of yourself. Proverbs 28 says, a hard worker has plenty of food, but a person who chases fantasies ends up in poverty. And I've been part of churches where there have been people who say, I feel like the Lord's going to return at any moment, so I'm going to quit my job and I'm going to devote myself to preparing myself and to help others be prepared for when the Lord returns. And my answer is, can we do both? You know what I'm saying, right? Because the thing is, if they do that, and then who's going to take care of them, right? And so Paul and Silas and Timothy, were in, they brought the gospel there. Paul says, listen, remember our model, remember our example. When we were with you, we worked hard, right? We didn't take food from other people. We weren't a burden to anybody else. I mean, they were bringing the gospel to them, and they were discipling people. They had a right to say to them, will you support us while we disciple people and while we bring people to the Lord, right? But they didn't say this. They said, no, we want to be an example to you. 1 Timothy 5:8, Paul says, anyone who does not provide for their relatives, especially for their own household, has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Well, how can he say that? Because working is part of our witness. If I'm at work, if I'm working somewhere and people know I'm a Christian, They're gonna take my work as the evidence of my faith. So I remember years ago when I was in college, I worked as a messenger in a law firm when I lived in Boston. And so I would walk around and deliver things to different places and things like that. I walked around. I wasn't a bike messenger, I was a walking messenger, right? So I would do that, but there was a lot of things to do in that job, a lot of it carry things and do all kinds of things for the lawyers and things. And people knew there that I was going to Bible college, I was going to become a pastor. And let me tell you, people said things to me, or I found out later people said things about me. They were watching how hard I worked and evaluating that that's what a Christian should look like. Now, they may not be Christians themselves, but if I was lazy, they'd be like, oh, you're a Christian, you shouldn't be lazy. I'm like, you're lazy? No. People have this idea because they're looking, they're saying, if you're a follower of Jesus Christ, does that make a difference in your life? See, a lot of people might say, I'm a Christian, but you couldn't tell. For many years, my mom worked for a company, and there was one other lady in her department who said she was a Christian. But this lady talked about everyone behind their back all the time. She gossiped. She said things about people. She would go to the boss to try to get people in trouble. And so my mom came into that department. People said, oh, yeah, so-and-so, the Christian. Then my mom came in, and that lady turned against my mom, right? And people get confused. They go to my mom and say, oh, wait a second. She says she's a Christian, and you say you're a Christian, but you guys look totally different. How is that so? You know? And so it gave my mom an opportunity to share about what it means to know Christ and to love Christ and to represent Christ well. So our work is part of our witness. The second thing we see, though, is our work is also, secondly, part of our worship. As believers in Christ, we should be the best employee. As I mentioned earlier in the service, Colossians 3, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters. God desires that you and I worship him. Why? Because when we worship him, we're aligning our hearts and our minds and our spirits and our actions with God. God will be glorified and other people will be blessed and will be blessed. Jesus says in Matthew 5, let your light shine before others. Why? That they may see your good deeds, your actions, and glorify the Heavenly Father. What we do has a direct impact on what people think of the Jesus that we say that we follow. There's a story I read that a man was negotiating to build a house, to buy a house, but he bought it without ever seeing it. And so his friend came to him and says, how in the world can you buy a house you've never seen? And this is before the internet, okay? You could go like look and walk, do a walkthrough through the house. And the guy's like, how can you buy a house you've never even seen a picture of it, right, essentially? And the man responds, he says, well, I know the man who's building that house, and he builds his Christianity into every brick of everything he does. All right? So what we do has a connection to our worship to the Lord and part of our witness to others. The third reason we work is to be able to help others. Paul says in verse 8, he worked so hard day and night. I mean, during the day, we know he was a tent maker working with canvas, right? He would work hard so he could sell the things he made and support himself. And then at night, when everyone would come home from work, they would gather and he would preach the gospel to them. He would disciple new believers, right? He was working day and night. Why was he doing that? Because he didn't want to be a burden to anybody else. He wanted to have the ability to actually help others. In Ephesians 4:28, Paul tells the church in Ephesus, anyone must work doing something useful with their own hands. Why? That they may have something to share with those in need. You know, the way I live my life and the way I control or use my finances has a big impact on, is it a blessing to me and those who are with me and my family? But also, do I even have the ability to help others? And that's part of what happens in our culture is we get so focused on acquiring things, and there's so many things to buy. And, you know, like, it's Labor Day weekend, there's sales. You know, I go out and buy things that I may or may not need, right? You know, but all those things impact my ability to help others. So Paul's basically saying to them, listen, when I was with you, I pulled my fair share, so I wasn't a burden to you, but also I'm able to help others. Now in verses 14 and 15, this is a section we need to kind of walk through carefully. So help, just walk with me through this. He says some things. We need to be careful how we understand this because it's been misunderstood in many ways. Verses 14 and 15, Paul says, take special note of anyone who does not obey our instruction in this letter. So we talked about these people are disruptive. They're people who are unruly. They're busy, but they're busy in the wrong things and causing problems. Paul says, if they do not obey our instruction, do not associate with them. Why? In order that they may feel ashamed. Yet don't regard them as an enemy, but warn them as you would a fellow believer. If there's someone doing something that's disruptive, and they're not willing to listen to good advice, and when other believers come and lovingly try to help them, they won't listen to that and say, no, I don't agree with you. I'm right. You know, Paul says, listen, you try to lovingly reach out to them, but if they refuse to listen, don't hang out with them. Don't be best buddies with them. Why? You want to do something that helps the person realize that they'll feel ashamed. They'll go, oh, wait a second. Boy, this doesn't feel right. Maybe there's something wrong. And maybe that'll open their heart to hear what you've been trying to tell them. Now, a quick point here. When you and I are ever going to reach out to somebody else that we feel is going the wrong direction, okay, one of my favorite verses in Ephesians 4, we are speaking the truth in love. Now, having been a Christian most of my life, I've run into Christians who think they are speaking the truth in love to me when they come and tell me all the things I'm doing wrong, right? You know, you ever met someone like that? Like, I really care about you and love you, so I'm going to tell you all the things you're doing wrong. Now, that's not speaking the truth in love. Because if I do something like that, or someone does something like that to you, the person can't receive what's being said because what's being said is not actually being said in a way that's going to help them. It's really more condemning them, right? So when you and I are reaching out to someone, Paul says, don't regard this person as an enemy, but warn them as you would a fellow believer. So this is my illustration here of that. So if I'm walking along, you and I are walking along, right? And I'm walking along, and you're gonna help me because you love me, right? What are you gonna do? You're gonna warn me, right? You're gonna say, hey, stop! So I remember when I was living in Boston one day, I was staying at a corner, and there were a lot of people around. We were all waiting for the light to turn so we could cross the street. And there was a mom across the street with two little kids. And one of them was really fussing, and she was paying attention to one kid, and the other one started walking into the street. And all of a sudden, all these people around who were strangers, they weren't fellow believers, right? They're strangers. They go, look out! And one of them reaches out and grabs the kid. And then another person, actually, he went out like this into traffic to try to stop the car because he didn't know someone else was going to grab the child. And he put himself kind of in danger to do that. That's what Paul's talking about here. We're not just telling people, you're doing something wrong. We're actually putting ourselves, we care about you. We're going to do whatever we need to do to kind of help you. Does that make sense? So Paul says some things here. We need to kind of get this right. He says, don't regard them as enemy, but warn them as you would a fellow believer. So how are we supposed to treat each other? Paul says in Ephesians 4:2, be completely humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love. That's what we're supposed to be doing for each other. So this is challenging for us. I don't know. I remember when I was younger, my family traveled to Pennsylvania. We went to Amish country in Pennsylvania. Has anyone ever been to Amish country in Ohio or Pennsylvania or somewhere else? Okay. All right. So what if my dad, we were at a gas station, and my dad started talking to the guy who was putting gas in his car opposite us, and he looked like he was Amish, but actually he was Mennonite because he was driving a car, and Amish don't do that. Right? So my dad started talking to him, and my dad started asking him questions. And one of the things he ended up talking about was, well, what do you do if someone's not following what the Bible says? And so this man shared with him that in his culture, they were not totally strict Mennonites, but they were pretty strict as far as using technology. They did do that. But they followed the same ways as the Amish would. And what the Amish and the Mennonites would do is if someone's doing something that's not according to the Bible, they shun them. They'll treat them as if they don't even exist. They won't talk to them. They won't have anything to do with them. Okay? Because that's what they think the scripture is trying to say here. Folks, that's not loving. If I walk up to you and say hi, and you pretend I don't exist, or you're kind of like, oh, hi, right? How am I going to feel? Am I going to feel like you care about me, that you love me? No. Everything we say and do isn't what the other person we care about them. So that's not what Paul's saying. Paul's saying, just don't be so associated with them, best buddies with them, and hanging out together, that they feel like everything they're doing is okay. We want them to know that everything they're doing isn't okay, but in the most loving way possible. Does that help? Okay? And then as our worship team comes, number three, what's the result of our hard work while we wait? You and I are working. We're working to take care of ourselves and our families. We're working so we're as a witness to others, what it looks like to be a follower of Christ. We're working as part of our worship to the Lord, let him know he's first in all that we do. We work so that others can be blessed, right? But what's the result of all that work? And Paul says something at the end here in verses 16 and 18. Paul says, as we're working for the Lord and taking care of ourselves and doing all these things, he says in verse 16, now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and in every way. You know, there's something that the world can never give. No matter what it offers, pleasure, possessions, all kinds of things, fame, it can never give peace, true peace. And peace is a gift from God. And peace isn't something you can make it happen on your own. You can't say, okay, I want to be peaceful now. You might be still. You might be quiet. But that's not going to make you peaceful. Because peace is an inner condition that comes from the connection we have with the Lord. And so as we're going to take communion in a moment, if someone to say, what's the gospel all about? Part of it is, you and I are at peace with God, which means that you and I can be at peace with others, true peace, and love them. And we can be peace in ourselves and accept ourselves and love ourselves, knowing we know that we're not perfect, and God knows that too, but he still loves us. So the peace that we have, why can we have that peace? Paul says in verse 16, the Lord be with you all. God's presence is with you. Do you know that? I mean, you might know it up here, but do you remember it? Was there a time this week when it really helped you to remember that the Lord is with you, actively with you, that he actively loves you, he cares about you, and wants to bring you through that moment? I think for all of us, that's true. As you stand with me, Paul ends the letter with the final thing that he wants us to experience. He says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. God's grace, he sent his son to die for us. As we celebrate communion, what we're going to do is we've got some buckets up here with the communion in them. And so maybe if you have children with you and you feel that they truly understand what Jesus did at the cross and what that means for forgiveness of their sin, then it's your, as a parent, invites you to make that decision, they can partake. If not, we can talk to them later on the way home about what that means. But if someone from each family maybe could come and grab the communion, we've got the little communion elements right here. If we can do that now, we're going to sing a song. I want you to come and get the communion. And then we're going to take communion together and pray, because today the Lord wants you to more fully experience His peace and His presence and His grace. Let's sing.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners was slain. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11 that we should take a moment before we take communion to examine our hearts. He says everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. What that means is really two things to think about. First, am I right with the Lord today? Am I really right? Am I really where He wants me to be? Am I relationship vertically with Him? Am I really walking with Him in ways that honor Him? If there's something that you and the Lord need to get right, this is the moment to do that. Because what we're about to celebrate cost Jesus everything to give you everything you could ever need. And secondly, am I right with others? Is there someone I've got a problem with, and they've got a problem with me? Am I really representing Jesus in that relationship the way that He wants me to? Or do I need to really, truly show the love of God in a way beyond what I've ever done? If that's the case, I encourage you this week, make that right. Get in the right place. So as we take communion together with a whole heart, with a pure heart, we can rejoice in everything that Jesus has done for us. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread." This little wafer represents that bread. Paul says, "When Jesus had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's take the bread together. Lord, we take this bread to remember your sacrifice, your body broken, what you went through physically, emotionally, willing to be separated from your Father so that we could experience your wholeness and your health, Lord, your wholeness in every way. We thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice, that you allowed yourself to be broken so that we can be made whole. In Jesus' name. Paul says, "In the same way, after supper, the Lord took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this when you drink it in remembrance of me.'" So we peel back that layer, take the juice together, represent the Lord's blood. Lord, we pray, we thank you that you gave of yourself, you gave of your very self, Lord. You gave your all to us so we could know what love truly looked like, so we could know what real acceptance and forgiveness looks like, to experience, Lord, your power transforming our character, transforming our words and our thoughts and our actions, your power transforming our situations in life and answering all of our needs. Paul says, whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And so, Lord, as we live in this time between your first coming and your second coming, we ask that your peace that goes beyond our understanding, that we will experience it at all times in every way, that we'll experience your presence, we'll experience your grace. We thank you for the cross. Let's sing together again.
To your rugged cross, I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, and exchange it someday for a crown. I will exchange it someday for a crown.
Now, Lord, having received your love, your amazing love, having been reminded, Lord, that you are ever with us and you have for us today a peace beyond our understanding, that you go with us, your presence is there. Lord, show it forth your grace in every part of our lives. We go, Lord, to represent you to those who desperately need to know of your love and your care and your forgiveness. We thank you for your love. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And together we say, amen. Amen. God bless you. See you next week. Hope to see you at an encounter next Sunday night.